Ja, okay.
Make this a little louder.
Yeah, so welcome to the lecture 9 of scientific programming. So today's topic is statistical visualization. Before we start with that, we as usual now look at the solutions of last week's homework. So make this a little bigger. Okay, that big enough?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so last week we had this homework that where we practiced the different like advanced topics of using pandas such as categorical data and time series. And so in the first, so we dealt with the Titanic data set. Can you look at it again? And it basically contained the features of passengers of the Titanic journey and whether they survived or not. And so the first task was basically to frame some of those columns in as a categorical data type, because it's rather categorical data. So the first thing was to turn the sex column into a category. So this could be easily done by just using S type category, because it's not ordered. So this does everything that you want. And then for the columns passenger, class, and embarked, we ask you to impose an ordering on these columns, because passenger class definitely has an order. And for the embarked, we said, okay, order them in the order of how the passengers were picked up. And for doing this, you needed to use this categorical D type. I think you could have also used PD categorical. But with categorical D-type, just made your own data type. You're basically saying which categories it has and whether it's ordered or not. And then you can use this new data type that you just constructed in this S-type method. And then finally, for the columns part, which says like how many parents or children the passenger had on board and the age. So these were basically more or less continuous variables, but we still ask you to turn them into categories just by discretizing these continuous values. And here the functions cut and qcut should have been used. Basically cut, with cut you can determine like where you want to make your cuts in, on the continuous scale. So here we said okay, go from minus 1 to 0, which basically like the ones without children or parents, then from 0 to 2, and then just to the maximum, so for the rest, and we call this no, few, and many, so giving also labels to these newly created categories. And then for Q-cut, this just cuts into the quantiles, and just cut into 4 quantiles here, and then we return the stuff, and then this basically looks like this, and doesn't look much different from the original data frame. Just, you know, we have strings instead of numbers, and under the hood, these are now categorical data types. So then the second thing was about pivot tables. So these pivot tables are these more or less nice abstraction to just compare the relation of two variables and compute some summary statistics over those combinations. And here we've computed two, so embarked against parched and sex against age. So here we can use the pivot table method, just say, okay, what values we want to aggregate. So this was the mean survival rate, or I can also interpret it as a probability maybe, and then saying which rows and which columns you want to have, and that's really all. And then for the other thing, we ask you to basically count how many people survived there. And here you needed to specify different aggregation function, because survival was either 0 or 1, and if you take the sum over it, you basically get the count. If you use count instead, you get like how many entries you have that have this combination at all, but not do not count the number of survivors. So and if you do this, then the pivot table looks like for embarked against parched, looks like this, and for the other one, it'll look like this. So then the second part was about time series. So here we return to this Ebola data frame. And here you basically should read in the data from the file system and turn the index into a time series. And for that, so I think many people just read in the data frame normally and then later on converted to a time series. But you could also use fast date here when you use, so when you call read CSV, and this will basically directly turn the date column into a time series. Also using infer date time format true, might make it a little faster. Then you can just use set index date, which will basically look for the date column and set the index to the date. And then we sliced out everything between August and January and only kept count status and country as a column. And finally we sorted also on the index, and then the data frame looks like this, so now date is the index, it's a labeled index, and we really have time datetime objects here, or timestamps. So, and then the final task was to use some smoothing. So again, here I first should have copied the data, just so you don't modify the original data frame. Then basically filter out only the cases. It's just the practices again. So if you say like a column equals something, then you will just do binary comparison and get a Boolean series, and you can use this to index the original data frame. In this way, only get the things where status actually equals, where the status column actually equals cases. And then you can just drop the status column because it just has the same value now, because if we filtered this out before. And then we can use pivot again. So pivot is like pivot table, but it does not compute any aggregation, it just flips rows into columns. And this is now not really the tidy format, but it's nice for plotting later on, because we can now say, okay, turn. Make a new, turn the country column again into its own column header, so that we get like columns here for each country, and then we resample the time frequency using a weekly frequency, so that we get like one entry for each week, and use forward fill for missing values here. And by the way, there's a difference between using a weekly frequency and a 7-day frequency, so I found that some people put 7D here, so, and then found that the result does not match exactly. When you just say 7D, you will basically start at the first date of your data frame, then go 7 days forward each time. If you have a weekly frequency, you will get a value for the first day of each week. So I'm not sure whether it actually starts at Sunday or at Monday, probably a Sunday because it's American format again. But so then you will just basically start at the first week, but the timestamp will be set to Sunday. So in this way representing the whole week and not just the first day and then 7 weeks, 7 days later. So that's a tiny difference, but yeah, still. So and then we can just use rolling 4 and basically get rolling average over 4 weeks and call the mean on that. And then our data frame looks like this. So we have these three NaN values because we cannot compute rolling mean across 4 weeks if you only have three values. And then what's very nice, you can just call dot plot on this data frame and actually get for each country get a curve, smooth curve that tells us the cases of Ebola over time. You see that fortunately most countries were spared. But yeah. Okay, any questions to the homeworks? Still? Okay. If not, then start with the topic. So I will just try to make this a little bigger still. As usually takes some time. Okay. Yes. Okay, yeah, so today's topic is statistical visualization. So we already had a full lecture on Matplotlib, where we made a lot of different plots, but statistical visualization is something that is more specific, and because of this we can use other libraries that get the job done much better and much faster than Matplotlib. So this really focuses on the idea that you have already described your data in terms of a data frame, and then these libraries that we introduced today make really use of the structure that is already describes your data and make really nice plots. So we focus on 2D plots with the statistical visualization. It doesn't really make so much sense to go in 3D because then you always have a different viewpoint, and this introduces a lot of complexity, so all these libraries really focus on 2D plots. And these libraries usually follow something that is called the grammar of graphics. So the grammar of graphics was a book written by Wilkinson in 2005, though I think this was already the second edition, the first one was probably already 99. And in this book, Wilkinson was also a statistician and a computer scientist, describes basically a declarative approach to describing graphics. and really going from raw data to the plot over various steps. And so he basically proposes, instead of this approach where you really say, like, draw this, draw that, we just have a declarative way of describing how our plot should look, and then we have some renderer that renders the plot for us in a very nice way. So you, this is the book. I think you should be actually able to read it here with our university access here. So it's really a recommendation. However, for those who probably don't have time to read it anytime soon, here's the very short version of the Grammar of Graphics. So the Grammar of Graphics basically are seven steps of how you go from raw data to the plot. And those are the following. So you start with defining variables. And this is basically what we already do when we create a pandas data frame. So we have some kind of data source. Now we say, okay, these are actually my variables. These are my columns. Then this book actually finds a whole formal algebra of how you can relate these variables to another. So this is basically where you say, okay, I want to plot this variable against those, and I want to combine those in a specific way. Yeah, so this part, this is usually not so important. We actually do the programming. Then there's a scale step where you would define, okay, I have what we talked about last time, these different levels of measurement. Do I have a categorical scale? Do I have a continuous scale? Do I have an ordered scale? So this can basically influence how your plot looks in the end very much. So now that we have our data, we can compute some kind of summary statistics over this. So this could just be, if we just have points, just the identity, but could also be that we want to compute means or counts, or also a whole regression line and plot this in the end. And then basically to this statistics, we say, okay, we now have them, we want to describe them by some kind of geometry. So say that we either map this to an area, or we have some lines to draw our regression line, or we actually have points to draw our points. And we need to define this, and then we can, in some cases, do some kind of coordinate transformation. So this is useful, for example, if you want to make a pie chart, you can say, okay, I want to map the proportion of my data set to the area geometry, then I just do a polar coordinate transform, and then I get a pie chart. So this allows basically to reuse some of the earlier elements and still maintain a lot of flexibility. And then really the final step is to map now these formal definition of a graph. So basically until here the book just talks about a graph, and then it basically turns into a graphic, something that you can actually view and perceive. And this would be like mapping now these formal definition to some kind of aesthetics. So saying it could be either shape, color, or just the position on the plot. And so basically, just seeing this is maybe a bit confusing, but will become much clearer when we actually look at the code for this. And so in general, it is that the libraries that we look at today, they really focus, or basically they are really much inspired by the idea of the grammar of graphics, but they do not exactly follow these protocol defined in the book. But they follow this idea of having a very, like a rather composable grammar to describe graphics. But this composable grammar instead of like having a lot of small, tiny functions that you have to remember. So rather reusable elements. One point now is that until now we always had some libraries that we could recommend to you and say, okay, if you want to do numerical computing, use NumPy. If you want to do pixel-perfect plotting, use matplotlib. If you want to do data frames, use pandas. However, for the statistical visualization field, that is not yet so clear in Python what is the best library to use for statistical visualization. So this basically brings us to one of like the most complicated points in programming, that is technology choices. So there are now, let's say, four or five different libraries, and then there's always some person who say this is much better than the other library, and you can basically argue forever about what you should actually use, and because you obviously also want to use the best thing and not the second one best thing. However, I will now basically show you some alternatives, but my recommendation is really pick the one that you like best and then just get good at using it. So all of them probably satisfy what you want to do in the end, and there's not so much point in comparing forever the different choices that you have, and probably just one is really enough. So this gets us to the libraries that we could use. So I'll show you four and the pros and cons of using them, and then we'll basically look at two in bigger detail. So basically two to really illustrate the idea of the grammar of graphics, but still there are more that more or less implement this idea. So the first thing that you could use is just pandas plotting. So pandas plotting is just the inbuilt plotting utilities in the pandas library. So you saw this already. If you just have a data frame and call dot plot on it, you get a nice plot that's somewhat is based on what you have in your data frame. And this, if you follow this link in the documentation, you can actually do a lot more and implements part of this grammar of graphics. So the cool thing about it is that you don't have an external dependency. It's already in pandas, and it's probably the quickest way to get a figure from a data frame. So it's also rather lightweight and easy to learn. The cool thing about most of those, they build on matplotlib, so in the background it's still matplotlib that creates the figures, so you still can get a reference to the matplotlib figure and try to do more customization than what is available through these libraries. So all these libraries are basically an abstraction above matplotlib, so they make a lot of things easier, but if you need more fine grained control, you can still get it if you really need it. And then another good thing is that this is officially developed by the pandas developers, so it's in the code base and has good support. However, it has somewhat limited capabilities compared to the others, and by default it's rather like basically a shortcut to matplotlib. It does not really look so good without more customization. So the next one is what we'll look today in great detail, ggplot, aka plotline. So ggplot or ggplot2 is the default or the de facto standard of doing a statistical visualization in R. And surprise, it was developed by Henry Wickham, so I already introduced this guy and said that he wrote most of the important R packages, and obviously he also wrote this one. And so now plotline is basically the port of this R package to Python. So now it's it's a complete Python implementation, but it has the same interface or tries to mimic the interface of ggplot. So the cool thing is that this is already standard in R, so there's a large community about around this way of doing graphics. You find a lot of examples on the internet, and it's really one of the best implementation of this composable grammar of graphics. It's also built on matplotlib, so you can still do customization with it, with matplotlib, and it also looks rather nice by default. So it looks basically very statistical. If a plot can look statistical, so that's what it would look like. However, the support is a little limited because this is really just one guy who said, okay, I like this way of doing things in R, but I also like Python, so I just write a port. Probably a very talented guy because he wrote this on his own, but there's still like just a single developer who supports this package. There's not like pandas where you have 1,000 contributors. So you might encounter a bug or two at some times. If you do and use this package, then it's nice if you file an issue on GitHub and someone can fix this. And also the interface is not what you would necessarily call Pythonic because it's ported from R, so it looks rather like something that you wouldn't do if you do really clean design of a library. And it's also not so widely used in the Python community, admittedly, but maybe that might change. So then the next thing is seaborn. We also look at this today at the end, and this is cooler because it was until recently it was the package to do this grammar of graphics in Python. So it's really a Python package. It has very powerful features. It's also customizable with matplotlib. And by default, this is probably the best looking plot you can get in just a single line of code. So if you use seaborn, it looks already very professional, even though if you didn't do much customization yourself. So, and it also has good support, I think, from PyData and Unfocus gets supported, and it is used by more people in the Python community than, for example, ggplot. The thing is that this is really a very high-level library, so there are a bunch of functions that you can call with your data and you get very nice plots, but there's not really this so much of this composable grammar where you can just add stuff together. So sometimes it's not really allows you or gives you the full flexibility of a grammar of graphics. So now the fourth thing, and then we're through and actually start with the coding. Is Altair. So Altair is probably the newest thing in this visualization landscape. right now, and this is developed by Jake Van der Plas, so you might also know this guy. We always or often have the recommendation to the Data Science Handbook in Python. It was also written by him, so he's a very active guy in the scientific Python community. And he wrote this package, but the idea is a little different than with the other three, so it's not just an abstraction above matplotlib, it actually builds in a different infrastructure that's called Vega. So Vega is really a specification language for plots, so basically is a grammar of graphics, but it's a JSON specification, so this basically targets JavaScript instead of Python. So the idea is that you have the specification of your plot, and then you send this to a renderer, and this gets just rendered in JavaScript right in your browser. And this Altair library is really just a wrapper around basically going from the Python data to this JSON specification, and then everything else is handled at the other hand, end of the line. So that's very nice because it's built on this very nice infrastructure of Vega, which was also, I think, like years of research of some visualization group went into this specification. So it's very cool that we can use this in Python now. So it really adds first-class support for web graphics. So all the other, if you have just matplotlib, you can still get a PNG, but you do not have really something that you can easily embed in your website. And it also adds a grammar, not just for graphics, but also for interacting with the plot. So this is very powerful. And it also has a full, like, it's really also a grammar of graphics. It's not just some high-level library. So this is very cool. And maybe this might become, in a few months or years, might become the standard of doing statistical visualization in Python. But it's not yet. And so there's not so much adoption yet. But this is really actively developed. So we'll see what the future brings, but for now we'll just look at ggplot and seaborn. So we do the usual suspects as imports, pandas. We have some dataset library here, and I should actually clear out the outputs so to not give give all the fun away. Guessing what plot might come out. Yeah. So we import this, and then today I really try to find some more proxy related data set, but I don't know. I didn't find really one, so we have cars data today. So this is not this is not interesting because it's about cars, but the data set is somewhat interesting because it has a lot of different variables. So it has a lot of variables, and the variables are also on different scales. So we have continuous and categorical and even time series data here. And we can try to see what we can do with those when plotting them in terms of this grammar of graphics. So as usual, we can do some description of the data and just look at stuff and find out, okay, here we have some NA values apparently, so we just fill them in with the median so we don't get problems when we do the plotting. And then we actually start with ggplot. So ggplot, as I said, the Python port is called plot9, and where you already see that it's not coming from Python, not from R, that you usually do from plot9 import star. This is something that you never do with like real Python package. Usually you always import at least some alias or so, but this is what the documentation does, and if you don't do it, it's also not so nice to use, because then you very often have to say the prefix. So we just do this for now in a notebook. It's probably also okay, but keep in mind that this probably shadows a lot of names that you would like to define yourself, and this can lead to very subtle bugs. So if you're on a larger software project, please don't do this. However, also what you should do is activate your library, your environment, so actually the stuff is there. Sorry for that. Just one second. Yeah, okay. Here we are again. And going back to where we just were, did this, and now the import also works, and now we have a lot of functions and classes imported in our global namespace. So what you do when you use ggplot, as I said, we go from raw data to a plot in the end. So the first thing that you do is you create a ggplot object and bind it to the data. So ggplot, as you can imagine, stands for grammar of graphics plot. So, and we have our cast data frame now, and we just bind it to, actually I cannot really see this, but bind it to ggplot, but maybe you can, not sure if it's really visible, but here is actually a plot, an empty plot window that you can probably see only on my screen. But so this basically happens if you don't specify any further, you just create an empty plot. You just say, okay, it's bound to the data set, but okay. Then the next thing that you would do is you have this kind of aesthetic mapping. So it's idea of mapping variables from your data set to aesthetics in the plot. So in this case, you first pass the data, and secondly, you pass this AES object, which stands for aesthetics. And there you basically define this mapping. So you say, okay, I want to map the X position in my plot to the acceleration variable in my data set. So there's a column acceleration. It's, how fast the cars are going, and you say, okay, now we want to add this to the plot, and this again just gives an empty plot. However, we already get an x-axis labeling here, so this has the right label and also the ticks are in the right range of the data. So now the final thing that you have to do is, now that you define this mapping, so we define the mapping to the data object and the mapping from the data variables to the aesthetics in the plot, you add some geoms, so some direct geometries that you can actually perceive, and just make use of this mapping that you defined before. So, and this happens by overriding the add operator, so ggplot override the plus operator, and now you can just add a bunch of geoms to your plot to make use of this mapping. So in this case we have the geom rug, and this just does the so-called rug plot. So like on a rug you have these small lines at the bottom, and for every data point in your data set, it just now draws one of these small lines. So this is really just a basic idea. Define, or like pass the data, define a mapping, and then say what kind of geometries you want to see based on this data. So once you understood this basic idea of doing plots in ggplot, then you really understood what this grammar of graphic things is all about. So is this understandable? Okay, cool. So now here comes my recommendation for formatting your ggplot code. So since you have to add a lot of stuff in the end, the lines can get very long, so it's nice to have it on different lines. And then what I always do is just wrap the whole thing in brackets again, and then everything that you add to the ggplot, put it on a different line and put the plus in front. This is useful because it allows you to later on just comment out line, and still the code would work as before. So everything that you add defines a different layer on your plot, and then you just can comment out one of those layers, can look how does it look with this layer, and comment it back in later on if you want to have it back. You don't have to reformat your code completely if you just want to change it one layer. So this is just completely equivalent to the thing above. And now what is really cool about, or by the way, this grammar of graphics idea is so powerful, is that you now have really a few primitives on, that define how you can talk about your plot. So instead of having a bunch of different functions that all have different configuration parameters, and you always have to look up the documentation and say, okay, where's the parameter, how I do this, how I do this, you just have a few primitives. So for example, if you now want to have this rug plot, instead of the x-axis on the y-axis, we can simply change this mapping and say, okay, instead of mapping x to the acceleration variable, I map y to the acceleration variable. And then, as you would maybe expect, this whole thing is now on the y-axis. So we didn't really have to go in here and say, okay, which parameter I have to... So sometimes there's a parameter maybe to flip the thing to exceed this, or there's a different argument that you need to pass, but this will work for more or less all geometries that you can add to a plot. This is always follow this simple pattern. So, and now you can add additional geometries to the plot. They're just extending this list of things that you add to the ggplot object. So, additionally to g, say in g on the rug, you can say, for example, g on density, and this gives us this density estimate over the data. So now you see that we still have the rug plot at the bottom that we had before, and just additionally we have thing this density estimate. This is really also in the idea of the grammar of graphics that when you add stuff, it will just be laid on top of the plot as an additional layer, so it will not influence what comes before and it will not influence what comes after. It will just be plotted as you expect. So by default, what ggplot does to save you a lot of code that you have to write is that it, all these geoms that you add to the plot, so to say, inherit the aesthetic mapping from the ggplot. So here we just defined that x should be acceleration. Now we can just add those and we don't have to define what the mapping is now. However, sometimes you might want to still have a different mapping for a geom. And you can do this, so for every geom you could still pass a different aesthetic mapping. So here we have the example of saying, okay, we still have the ggplot of cars and x to acceleration, and then we do a geom density in red. So still every geom can take some specific configuration parameters, so changing the color here. And this would draw the density of the acceleration variable. But now if we have at a second geom density, this would just look the same by default, but we can pass a different aesthetic mapping where we now map x to a horsepower and color this in blue. And then we see that we get two different density curves. And the red one is for acceleration, the blue one is for horsepower. So we can override this if you want to. But in general, it's not so often needed. The general pattern as well, that you define what you want to map at the top and then just use different geoms to visualize this. And then these labs thing is a different, it's not really a geom. This is goes more under the title of guides, where you say, okay, I want to add some guides to my plot. And for example, we can here just change the x-axis label. Because this is not, if you have different mappings, this does not figure it out by default anymore. So it would just be acceleration. I think if we comment this out, let's demonstrate it, then it's just acceleration. It just also inherits the thing from the ggplot object that we created at the top. Yes? Sorry? You mean like this here at the bottom?
Yes.
This is because geom density for some reason draws this line here at the bottom, and so if you have a blue and a red line both at the bottom, it turns out to be purple. Yeah, I also don't know why this line is here. All this helps. So now, since we understood now the basics of ggplot, we can actually go into more different geoms that we can use and see how we can use this to explore single variables and the relation of different variables to each other. So, as you know, a very popular thing to do is just the histogram, and by doing geom histogram, we get a histogram of our data. And again, here it's very nice that we already get a x label and a y label by default. So usually when people do plots, they tend to forget doing the axis labeling, and because they just want to get a plot quickly, and then in the moment you do the plot, you still know what you see, but when you look at it 5 days later, it's just like meaningless points. And so this is very nice that this does it by default, and also it's really, you just have to specify once what you do here. You don't, like in matplotlib, you would have to pass the data and then you would have to do the labeling afterwards. And this is really non-redundant code where you just specify once what you want to plot and then you get a label by default. So as you already saw, so actually some of these geoms, or really all of these geoms, have a statistics, a so-called stats object underneath that they use to compute what they display. So for example, a geom, a histogram is actually just a count of things. So by default, it will do the count of the data. And many geoms are actually just like aggregation of less complex geoms and stats combined into a a new geom. So for example, you could do a histogram also by doing a bar, a geom bar, and then a stat pass the geom bin, or no, pass the stat bin. So basically do a bar plot with binning, and this will actually look the same thing as look the same as a histogram. So often these things are just compositions of less complex things, and you could also get them this way, but it's nice if you have them somewhat aggregated. And yeah, so by default, geombar would use the stat identity and really just plot the original values of the data. But doing this, you can get a histogram. And then also, as you already saw, geoms can be customized by passing additional keyword arguments to them. So a histogram can have more bins. By default, it has some number. You can just pass a different number here, and then we get a different looking histogram. So now there's something that is a little bit tricky, is if you want, for example, to make a normalized histogram. So there's, as I said, there's not necessarily always an option to do this, but rather a general way of how you would achieve this. So here we just plot a normalized histogram over a density and see, okay, this matches up. But the way we achieve this is by passing a separate aesthetic mapping to the histogram. And in this aesthetic mapping, we now say y, so axis still mapped to acceleration, this is okay, but y now should be instead of being mapped to the count, it should be mapped to the density of the data. And this, so ggplot behind the scenes computes a density variable for you if you want it. But to be able to access this, you have to wrap this in a string in a so-called calc expression. So if you have calc and then brackets, and then you can do some kinds, you could also do some mathematical operations here, but you can also access these variables that are get defined only behind the scenes. But this is something that you just have to know and have to learn about ggplot, that it's not really something that you can easily figure out by just trying out different geoms. So that there you should just need to know that there can be a density variable computed behind the scenes, and then you the y-axis have to the density, and also again very nicely it now gets a density label instead of a count without us doing anything additionally. Okay, so then the next thing that we already also saw on Matplotlib is doing box plots. This can be achieved by geom box plots. Something that is a little strange about box plots is that they want an x and a y, so you would probably expect that you could just pass a single variable, but you definitely need both, and if you just want to make a box plot for a single variable, you need to pass something for x. So here we just pass 1, and then on the x-axis it gets mapped to 1, and then we get a box plot for a single variable, which is also a bit broad. But box plots are nice because they really give a comprehensive overview about the distribution of a variable, so we see like the minimum and the maximum, the first quantile, the second, so the median of the second quantile and the third quantile. And we can already see from this that the distribution of acceleration is probably not very skewed because the median is more or less in the middle between the other two quantiles. So this is it for exploring a single variable. Now we basically look at exploring the relation of one continuous variable and another categorical variable. And here we see how the power of ggplot really comes into play, because for getting a box plot of different for different categories, all we have to do is saying, okay, y should still be mapped to acceleration, but x now, instead of just being mapped to mom, should be mapped to origin. So origin was a column that basically defines where the cars were produced, so it can be either USA, Europe, or Japan. And what we get now is that we get a different box plot for each of those origins. So what happens behind the scenes now is the ggplot does a group by based on this origin origin variable. So this would be equivalent to a group by origin, then getting each group, then computing the box plot on this, and then displaying the box plots side by side, and then also figuring out this axis labels. And this is all here just done for you by just saying, okay, I want x to be mapped to origin. And we see that right. This is still has the right label, and it's also the ticks get the right description. And this is really fast to get the overview about this distribution for different groups. Now another thing that is not so often done with matplotlib, but you see more often in ggplot land, is doing geomjitter. So jitter is something where you just say, okay, I now put the original data points from my data set across, or basically on top of whatever I computed here, and then just randomly distribute them, or just randomly shift them, or jitter them, in fact. So this just gives us an intuition about how much data we actually have and how the data is distributed. So, I mean, boxplots are nice for getting an overview, but sometimes it's also nice to see, okay, how much data do I actually have to support this boxplot, or how sparse is my data? Yes?
Well, what does the x axis mean for the scatter plot?
For the jitter? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this just means that so all the points that belong to the hero group will basically, in general, should be put here. If you so you can set a width here. If you set this probably to zero, it would just be. Not sure if we can do this. No. Could have been. However, so they would be all lined up here on this exact thing, and then there's just like some random noise that just shifts the data points a little left and right. So the point is just to see how much data points do I actually have to support this box plot.
So you jitter them just so that you can see them all.
Yeah, exactly. So there's so basically on this so the x-axis so means only something as much as it belongs to this group, but it doesn't mean something to being a little more left or a little more right. Okay. So then another really cool thing for looking at this combination of continuous and categorical variables is the violent plot. So the violent plot we also saw already with matplotlib, so this is somewhat like the box plot, but it does it basically a density estimate of the distribution of the data. So we can see here, so and this is really nice for seeing how skewed the data is. So we saw here that here, okay, the median is not so much in the middle, that here's data, we see that the data is rather distributed the same on both sides. However, here this data is heavily skewed for Europe cars. At this point, so the data is just for cars from the 70s, so doesn't say anything about nowadays, but at this time apparently Europe cars tended to have like rather low acceleration, and there were a few that had very high acceleration, but it was not so evenly distributed as, for example, in the USA. So then to make these violent plots already a little nicer, we can do something else. And you cannot just add geoms to a plot, you can also add stats directly. So as I said, every geom has by default a stat associated with it, but also every stat by default has a geom associated with it. So the summary statistic just compute, the summary stat just computes the mean and the standard deviation of the mean. And it displays this by putting a point here and by putting a line around this point by default. So you can also even look at this without the violin plot. Then you get also a somewhat comprehensive overview about your variables. But doing this in combination, you can see the mean and the density at once. And what you can do also is just combine the violin plot with the box plot, so to get both the advantages of getting really this continuous density estimate, but also seeing right where is the median, where are the quantiles. And this just fits nicely together, and especially if you make the width of the box plot a little smaller. And then it also looks more like a violin. So. Yeah. Sometimes it's also helpful to just look at the one-dimensional density, and here we map to a different aesthetics. We map, instead of just mapping to X to Y, we now see that there are different aesthetics mappings that we can use, for example, fill. So fill would be something that is not just the outer color of the geometric object, but it's really like the color inside of this object. So if we map this to fill, then we get like three different density estimates for each of those groups of origin. Here we have like miles per gallon, so basically how much fuel you need to drive a certain way, and we see that it's the other way around. It's like how far you can get by a certain amount of fuel. So we see at this time the US cars actually like needed more fuel apparently, and the Japanese cars were the most environmentally friendly. So now we just have a comparison with what matplotlib code you would have to write. So we first do this now instead of a density with a histogram. So we do more or less the same thing, and now the only thing that we have to do additionally is set the alpha value. We already did this here, that we set the alpha value. So alpha is the transparency, right? So if you have alpha equals 1, it's like totally opaque, you cannot see through it. But if you have alpha something smaller, it's like gets transparent. And then we also have to do position identity, because by default the position is stack. This would be the default, and then it just like stacks different or like tries to put the histograms on top of each other. And for me, this is actually a little bit hard to read. I mean, you can say, okay, here the US value was very high, and then there was just a very small, probably just a single count for Europe and Japan. But I always feel it's like, okay, there was a very high count for Europe. So I like this much better, doing the identity here. Wait. Yeah. Yeah, so then it's just opaque and just everything grounded on the bottom of the x-axis. And now we just look at the matplotlib code that we would have to write to get this in matplotlib. So first we would have to actually save some code. We can define what variables we want to plot and what variable we want to split on. So we want to plot the miles per gallon, and we want to split the groups on the origin. And then we first have to create a figure and an axis. We can use the subplot function. And then we do a group by on the cars, on the variable to split, and group by objects are actually iterable. I'm actually not sure if we showed this yet, but you can just use them in a for loop. And what you get out is both the name of the group and then the data frame where this this basically comes out when you filter based on this group. So you would get like three iterations here with Europe, Japan, and USA as name, and then these different data frames that only have European, Japanese, or US cars. And then you call the hist method on the axes with the And here you can use this data keyword, so you can at least you can pass the data frame now. You couldn't do this until recently, and then just pass the string of the variable you want to plot. So you don't really have to pull out the series. You can do it like this, but you also have to pass a label here, and then later on you have to set the x label and the y label, because that is not done automatically. And you also have to set the legend, and you also have to set the title of the legend. So doing this almost. I mean, the colors are a little different in the size of the plot, but semantically that's the same plot. And now if we compare this, these were two lines, these were a little more, and the thing is not the number of lines of codes that you have to write, really like a boilerplate that you would have to do every time. So you always have to think about, okay, which group I do I have to do, how do I have to do it, and this is really like when you want to analyze data exploratively, this is not the things that you should think about. You should just think about, okay, what kind of data do I want to look at? I don't think about what kind of group wise do I have to do to get the plots. So just to show, yeah.
Also slightly different, why is
that? Because ggplot by default tries to mimic the ggplot style from R. You mean like also the density looks a little different? Okay, yeah, so this is somehow not sure. I tried to, if I set the bins the same, so I made the bins a little
different bins, that's
differently,
right.
but still I think it didn't look totally the same, right?
Yeah, there's like one very high bar at the above plot.
So I actually don't know if like under the hood they try to use some kind of different binning procedure, so it just tries to make it look a little bit differently, but in principle, this is more or less the same. So densities kind of match up. Yeah, it could also be that if you do this, that it just does the binning, so to say, or just on the sub-data set. And if you do this, it tries to do binning at least, so still for the whole data set. So it divides like the whole range of data into 30 bins. And matplotlib, if you pass it to it, it just like divides every subgroup into different 30 bins. So this plot is then even better because it has comparable bins and not different bins for each subgroup. That's what I could imagine. Okay. So the next up, we now had a single variable, then a single variable, and a continuous variable, and now we have two continuous variables. So what we do here, we have force power against weight in some unit that I can't interpret, but it's just weight. So the simplest thing that you can do is just a scatter plot. The scatter plot you get by doing gm dot point, no, gm underscore point. So this really just draws the point. The points at the position where they are. It's very easy to interpret. However, these kind of scatter plots can suffer from something that is called overplotting. So if you have just the same data point very close to each other, like here, we cannot really distinguish how many data points are there actually, because they are so close to each other. And additionally, if the data points are really exactly on top of each other, we can also not distinguish it. So it could in theory be that this data point just occurs a million times here and we just do not see it and say, okay, most of the data is somewhere here. A way to avoid this is using density, now not just in one but in two dimensions. This is a two-dimensional density estimate of the data distribution. And by default it does like this contour levels and basically it says like where the circle is smallest, there's the highest density of data. And then as the circles get bigger, the density becomes less. So this is then something where we don't have this overplotting. This is like a comprehensive way of putting the data in something that we can interpret easier. And to make this a little nicer, we can add more levels. So basically each of these lines that is drawn here is a level, and then we say levels equals 10, and then we just get 10 of those lines. And yeah, this makes it a little bit more interpretable, especially in those areas like this are not, the data is not totally centered. And just by looking at this, we can already see that there's a high covariance between horsepower and weight. So basically, if we go towards more horsepower, we also increase in weight, which kind of makes sense. If the car is heavier, we probably need more power to get it going at all. And apparently it's not it wasn't so popular to build cars that had like these combinations of horsepower and weight for some reason. So what is even nicer is instead of having these contour levels is having color. So again we just have X and Y here, and what we do now, we use instead of using the geom density 2D that we had here, we use the stat density 2D. And now we pass a different geom to it, so we use a polygon geom, which means polygon is probably like the most flexible thing that you could have. And then you pass a different mapping where you say, okay, I want to map the fill of this polygon to the level. And here again we have to use cult because level is a variable that is just computed behind the scenes that is not available in our standard namespace right now. And this is again something that you just have to know, but then what happens is that the fill of these polygon levels is just mapped to the value of the density. And then this, in my opinion, is like even more interpretable than just looking at the lines. However, we see that here it's not going completely through, so this is when I say this library is not completely bug-free. So you might find things that look a little strange sometimes, and this is something that, where development still has to go on. So an alternative to doing this kind of density plot that also avoids overplotting is doing a so-called count plot. So a count plot is achieved by doing geom.count, okay, that's easy. And then what this does is then if several points are basically on top of each other, it draws just a bigger point around it. So we can see that we have a lot of data points actually here and here. Actually not sure if we could see this in original data frame in the original scatter plot properly, but not so well as you could see it here. So I think there are also groups points that are very close to each other together, and then this puts them into a single bigger point. And so, and if this point now was there a million times, then we would now see this, because it would be turned into a giant block. But now we are sure that this is actually not the case. So another thing that you can do in ggplot that is not so easy in matplotlib is doing or adding regression lines. So this is achieved by using the geom smooth. So this just draws a smooth line through the points, and this gives you, so to say, a comprehensive estimate of how the data relates to each other. And if you just do geom.smooth, by default it uses an approach called lowest smoothing. So lowest smoothing is like stands for local regression. And what this does is actually it like shifts a moving window across the data, and then in each window it computes a regression line just based on this data. So we just would take this data and draw a line through it and go somewhat further and draw the next line. And then based on all of these lines, we compute a smooth line, a smooth version of this line in the end. So the cool thing about this is non-parametric. You don't have to decide on degrees of a polynomial that you want to use to model your data. It just manages to do a smooth line somehow. However, if you want to, you can just also get the classical straight line, the classical linear regression to your data by switching the method of the smoothing geom and setting this to LM. So an LM stands for linear model. And there again, we see that this is really derived from R, where more or less everything is seldomly more than a three-letter abbreviation of something. So therefore, it's called linear model. And what we also see here is that we get these grayish bands around the line. And this is a confidence estimate of the standard error of this regression. So this also tells us how sure, basically, this this regression is of going there. And we see that we don't get this here for the standard lower smoothing, but we get a warning that it's not implemented. It would be there in R, it's not yet in Python. But if you don't want this, you can also set SE, which then stands for standard error, to false. Then you don't get this thing. So now what we see here is that we have, I think until now we rather had just two aesthetic mappings, but they can have much more aesthetic mapping. So now what we do, we have force, power, and weight still for x and y, but we also have the color now to origin. So in this way, what this will do is that it will color the points based on the origin, okay, but it will also do this grouping and will basically make sure that these two geoms are computed for each group in separation. So now we get a regression line for each of those groups. For each of those groups separately in the respective color. So this is also nice because now we can see that these lines are more or less parallel, and we can basically derive from this that the relation between horsepower and weight does not depend on the origin of the car. So this relation seems to be somewhat constant. Yes?
Wasn't it like that Europe's cars have the best acceleration?
Yes, but acceleration is not in here.
Yeah, it's just funny that the cars from USA have so much horsepower, but still don't have the best acceleration.
Yeah, probably. So you just need some time to get going, but then you can get. Many of us are probably like pickup trucks or something. Okay. And something else that I find would be rather hard in matplotlib to do, and is very easy here, is annotating plots. So there's another aesthetic mapping called label that you can use, and as you maybe not remember, but in the cars data frame, let's look at it again, we had a column called name, it just has the name of the car in there. And now what we can do is we have the points here, and we have a geom text, and we just set the vertical alignment, so again these two letter R things here, to top, and what this does is grabs the mapping from the label and just puts the text there just below the point. So this is So here we just reduce the data to the first 10 data points, because otherwise the plot would be completely crowded and you couldn't see anything. But for annotating a few data points, this is very easy, I think. And now we can see that this data point actually belongs to this ambassador car. We could. What you can also do is, if you want to have the exact or want to know the exact values of your point, you just map the label again to a numeric variable. And what this one does, it just draws the numeric, or just writes down the numeric value of this point. So I mean, we can see from here that horsepower is probably somewhat around 190, but we don't know exactly. So this can be helpful if you need to know the exact values, have them in your plot. So okay, until now we had just at most, three variables, I think, that we combined, but now we want to do even more, and we can do so using even more aesthetics. So okay, we just looked at the our data frame again and see that we have a lot of more variables here. And what we can do is, so we now want to include more variables into a plot, right? In total we have 8, I think, 2, 3, 4. We even have 10. So we want to include more. So we need to find, since we just have two dimensions, we need to find more aesthetics that we can actually map our variables to. And what we can do here is use color now as a additional aesthetic and still just do the point. But what we get now is that the continuous variable miles per gallon is now mapped to a continuous color scale. So we just get this color bar here, and this tells us that or tells us the value of miles per gallon, and this also is now reflected in the coloring of the points here. So we see that the cars that are very energy efficient are here at the bottom, those that are very light and have low horsepower. This also makes sense, and as we go to higher horsepowers and higher weights, the efficiency quickly drops. So now, what else can we do? There is another variable called displacement. So displacement is Hubraum. So the what did I write? Copy here from Wikipedia, the swept volume of all the pistons inside the cylinder. So how much space there is when the piston goes down into the motor there. And we can map this to another aesthetic called size. So size, if we do this, we basically also make the size of the points proportional now to the continuous scale of a displacement variable. So this way we already combined 4 variables here. And again here we see that those with larger displacement are also the ones that are heavier and thus have higher horsepower and that are less energy efficient. So it's actually nice to see that all of those four variables correlate with each other in this direction here. What you usually want to do when you make things proportional to scale is not just map it to size, or just like doing this the size mapping to variable, but you want, because this just makes the linear range of the point proportional to the value of the variable, but instead you want to make the area of the point proportional to the value of the variable, and for that you just have to square the variable. So because and this can be very easily done in plot 9 just by setting this not to displacement, but to displacement to the power of 2. So this is just a Python expression to square something, and you can just put this in the string here, and this would get evaluated as this variable squared. And this is set to be for humans, like it's for us it's easier to perceive something. We rather look at the area of something than just at the linear scale of something if it's like the size of a point. So this is something to keep in mind if you use the size aesthetic. Consider to make it equivalent to the square of the variable. And this also makes this even more visible that cars, or like the displacement increases when we go in this direction. So now we want to add a categorical variable. So again, we're interested in this origin. We often use size for it, but now we have used up size already. So, oh no, we have used up color already. We usually use color for this. Another thing that we can use is shape. So we now set just the shape to origin, and what happens now is that we get for each of those three different origins, we get a different shape that gets displayed as points. So now the cars from Europe are round points, cars from Japan are triangles, and the cars from US are these squares. And so now we're at the point where it already becomes a little bit hard to see, but I think we can still see that most of the cars here on top are really US cars, and that here we have some cars, or many cars also from Europe and Japan down here. But apparently those did not tend to make those very high, heavy, high horsepower cars. So this is like almost the most that we can get just on a standard two-dimensional display. And now there's another technique which allows us to get in even more variables in a single plot. So in this plot, is, this method is called facets in ggplot. It also goes under a lot of different names, so also small multiples is something that I heard. And the idea is just, let's show you the plot, so you know what I'm talking about, is that here we say, okay, we still have x and y, and then we have, in the end, we add a so-called facet wrap, and we have a variable here, origin. Now what happens is that the same plot is just repeated for these different groups. So we have the scatter plot, and we get a different scatter plot for each of those different three origins, and on top we have a label, what it actually is. And this also makes sure that the extents of the plot stay the same, so we can actually compare compare the plots. So it's not that it tries to, like, usually we try to make the plot only as big as the data, but here we can actually see that most of the data from Japan, Europe just lies in this lower quarter here. And so the plots can also share the y-axis, which is nice. Okay, so let's get back to our previous example and adding more variables to that. So we have a cylinders variable, and this just, okay, gives the numbers of cylinders in the car, and we do a facet wrap now on those cylinders. So what this does is, okay, we have apparently cars with 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8 cylinders, and we get a very small plot, or we get a small plot for each of those different groups. You already see that there were not, so apparently was all in Japan, that was in trend to make three-cylinder cars, but this did not really succeed. Also, German Europeans tried to make five-cylinder cars, and probably also was a better idea because there weren't so many, but most have four, six or eight, so we want round numbers for cars, apparently. So what facet wrap does it basically makes this small plot, this facet, and then it just aligns, or basically puts them all side by side, and after a certain amount of columns, it wraps around. So it starts a new row after a certain amount of facet it made. So we can control this behavior by specifying either the number of columns or also specifying the number of rows. So if you, for example, say number of columns equals 2, then we just get 2 columns, and it wraps around after completing 2 columns. But with this, we can more or less just make a single variable here that we can wrap around. There's another facet thing that is called facet grid. So in this facet grid, we can specify two variables and make one on the rows and one on the columns. So this is what we are going to do now. But first, we turn the here column, which is right now a time series or timestamp column, into an integer column. Because otherwise it cannot really be handled by ggplot. So now see, okay, returned. I just re-access the year of the year column and makes this into year int. And now what we do here is we use facet grid, and we have cylinders now against year integer. And we also add this theme. So theme is something that you can add and specify like some configuration for your plot, such as the figure size. And because now we need to make the figure a little bigger to still be able to see things. We also have to wait some time to actually complete this. Yes. Okay, so now what we have here, we have facet grid, we have cylinders on the rows, so we have those here. And we also have the year now in the columns. So now we see how across the years the cars that were manufactured changed, and we can see that this five-cylinder trend apparently just started in 1978 and was abandoned already in 1980, and that these four cylinders stayed pretty constant across the years, and that eight cylinders apparently they were apparently pretty trendy here, but then there weren't so much cars made towards the end of the 80s, 70s anymore. So now looking at the original data frame, we have cylinders, we have displacement in the plot, we have horsepower, miles per gallon. The name is probably not, like, we could put the text labels here, but this really would make it totally unviewable. So we leave this out for now. We also have the origin, we have the weight, we have the year. So what's only missing is now the acceleration. So how do we get this into the plot? The only way to do this is by adding additional facets. However, acceleration is continuous, so we just turn into a categorical variable, just for the fun of it. So we describe this and see, okay, we have some distribution here that is not totally skewed, so we just use Q-cut here to cut it into three different quantiles and slow, middle, and fast cars, and add a new column called acceleration cut here. So that this worked, and now what we do here in the facet grid is we can use a so-called formula expression. So for facet grid, instead of doing this thing where we say, okay, we have a list of those two variables, what you would usually do in R is having this formula expression here, and where is it? And what you would do is you would say cylinders, and then this little snake or tilde thing, and then cut. So this basically separates what is in the rows and what is in the columns. And what we can now do is we can just add things together here, either for the rows and the columns, and this would create a cross product between all possible values for the cylinders and the acceleration. So you remember that we had like five different values for the cylinders and three different values now for acceleration, and if we add this together and make the cross product, we should get 15 combinations of this now in the rows. However, ggplot is actually smart enough to not do this and just display the rows that are actually there. So if there's something like eight cylinders with fast acceleration, it's probably not there, so it does not display it. And yeah, here it is. our final plot, where we have like, so you see, okay, there was nothing like that was fast with three cylinders, so it's not in there. But now we see that, yeah, this just gets combined here in this header, and we can now look at really all the variables of our rather many-variable data frame in just a single plot. So admittedly, this is, if you look here and we have the size mapping, this is not totally viewable, especially since the plot is not interactive. But at least it's a way to look at many things at once, and we kind of overdid it here just to demonstrate how you could do things like this. Yes?
Can you make this interactive somehow?
Not really, I think. So, I mean, like with matplotlib, okay, I mean, what you can do is instead of doing matplotlib inline, do matplotlib notebook, and then you can hover over it and probably get some kind of value with your mouse pointer. And you can add interaction with matplotlib, but this is not so easy. So if you want interactive graphics, I would really recommend Altair instead, because it really makes it easy to also make plot make dot like this, but then also make them easily interactive.
Nice if you could zoom in and then you can also display the names of the...
Yeah. Yeah, so you can do this as a bonus exercise. yeah, cool. Yeah, just to say this, so instead of using this formula expression where we add stuff together in Python, we can also add use nested lists. So basically, you have a list of lists, and then the first expression is a two-valued list where we have cylinders and acceleration for the rows, and then just the year for the columns, and that just gives the same plot that you just saw above. Okay, so before we go to Seaborn now in the last 15 minutes, just the final feature that is admittedly also available in matplotlib, but also but also available in ggplot, that you have an XKCD theme, and if you hand this in to your reviewers, this is sure to get your paper published without further questions. Okay, so next thing is Seaborn. Unfortunately, we don't have so much time anymore. However, we'll just quickly look at it. So Seaborn is really different from ggplot, that you have more like high-level functions that you call with specific configuration parameters, and then you just get very nice plots. So in Seaborn, since it's a real Python package, it's not import star, it's import Seaborn as SNS. And then you first thing you usually do is call sns.set, which just like sets a lot of style defaults, because really Seaborn is probably the library with the nicest styles, and we should make use of this. And this here you could also do a lot of configuration, but just calling it without parameters just sets it to the defaults. And then we just recreate our data frame, and because we've messed up so many variables that we don't care about anymore. And then probably the most useful function of Seaborn is called pairplot. So this, what this does, is a scatter plot matrix. And if you like plots all variables against all other variables, and just here, so we see no acceleration. And okay, unfortunately this is too big to get a video on the screen, but so to say, we have a matrix across combinations of different variables in our plot. So we have now weight against acceleration, this plot here, but also weight against cylinders, weight against displacement, and everything against everything, and then on the diagonal, so these things are just flipped more or less. And what's also nice, so on the diagonal you get the histograms of the variable, of the single variable. So if you get a new data set, this is really something that you can do just by default, just make a scatter plot matrix and look at this stuff. It's just a single command, that's pretty nice. And so Seaborn also has this idea of mapping aesthetics to variables in your data frame. However, some aesthetics are just called different, some are not there at all. And it also doesn't use this AES object that you have to create. You just pass additional keywords to the functions. So here, for example, color is called hue now, because color is already used by matplotlib, so they call this hue. So we can also do the same pair plot, just additionally using origin, mapping the origin to the hue. And then in all of these small scatter plots, we now also get the color for the different origins. So the US cars in blue, Europe cars in green, and Japanese cars in red. And by default it also stacks the histogram, so it's something that people like to do apparently. So this is how you can already view like a lot of variables just in a single command. Okay, then let's look a few SNS functions that you can, or Seaborn functions that you can use and that are helpful. So for example, a displot just gives a histogram and a density estimate at once. And okay, there's also a box plot here, you don't need to specify x and y. And this is, I think, what is like typical for Seaborn. So it really is just like a single function, and it does a lot of things at once. So this, if Seaborn already does what you want more or less, then it's very nice to use. And you all like thing like these plots, it has this transparent histogram, so, and it looks very nice to me. But it's not, if you want to do something that is not available through the functions directly or as a configuration, then it might be a better idea to go with ggplot. So now we also do what we just did with ggplot in very short time. Okay, we have continuous variable against categorical variables. So again, the idea is similar. You pass the data now not to the ggplot object, but as a keyword. You pass the mapping as keywords. We call box plot. We get again these plots, these three box plots split across the groups. Okay, so something that is not in ggplot right now is a swarm plot. So this is something comparable to this jitter, where you put the original data points just on, just there. But instead of just randomly jittering them left and right, you put data points that are more or less the same just next to each other. So this gives you like an estimate of the distribution. Of the distribution, but also of the density of your points. So you see how many points you have, but also where are the most points concentrated. So, and this is usually something that you would like to overlay with a box plot. So here we do this, and we adapt the color here. Now again we see this box plot and also the original data points on top. And here we see also one of, in my opinion, the greatest weaknesses of Seaborn, because here we just, we can combine plots as in ggplot, not by adding them, but just by calling two Seaborn functions below each other, okay, but we have to pass the same data again, and we also have to pass the same mapping again. And I mean, if you edit, you can just copy the line, but this really duplicates codes, and this is not so nice and cannot so easily. Now, if you want to make the same plot now with two different variables, you have to edit in two places, and yeah, it's not so cool. You can also make violin plots. They also look nicer as in than a ggplot. They have these mean and quantiles by default in there. Something that is nice about violin plots that I want to show you is a like, little twist that you can do. So if you have a binary categorical variable, you can use this to split the violin plots. So by default, the left side just mirrors the right side and doesn't give any additional information. So now we just split the year variable into old and young cars, however they are all old since they are just from the 70s, and demonstrating this, and then we can map the hue to this new age thing, and then we say split equals true. Now we get on the left side, we get a grouping for this for the old cars, and the left side something for the young cars. So this is something if you have an experiment and you have two conditions and you want to compare them, and you can put the violin plot side by side and really see, okay, how does it influence the distribution when I change this condition. Another thing that ggplot offers, C1 offers, is this vector plot, which just okay gives the mean and the standard deviation and just draws a line through it. So this also can tell you if you have different conditions in your experiment, you can see how does influence the mean by default in this. Okay, then for two variables, Seaborn also has a lot of things, most notably the join plot. So the join plot is something that so does two things. So it also by default just does a scatter plot of the data. That is nice, but in the margins of the plot, so to say, it also gives an estimate of the single variable. So it draws a histogram of the single variable now in the margin, so you can see both how variables behave on its own and how they relate to each other, and it also computes the Pearson correlation coefficient just by default and writes them down in the plot. What is kind of cool? Yes.
Sorry, the error message. I know it was just a keyword
oh, yeah.
Identity, but is it in Seaborn? Is it still old? Is it deprecated or?
Seaborn is not deprecated. It's like in so Seaborn uses matplotlib, and apparently in their code they still use the old matplotlib keyword and didn't care to update yet. So, but you can submit a pull request and contribute. So what is kind of nice? It's also the hex bin plot. So this is kind of two-dimensional histogram. So again, another way to avoid this overplotting of different points on a scatter plot. And this draws just this hexagonal things here and makes the color basically proportional to the density of the points there. So you get this by using kind equals hex. And this is something, again, where you see like the Seaborn style. It's not just adding a different thing to it, but you really have to know or have to look up, okay, join plot has a kind keyword argument, and what kind of things can I pass to kind, what is valid, where do I get an error. This is where it's not so nice, but the plot is very cool in my opinion. You can also do kind equals reg, which does a regression line from the point, and for some reason now also estimates density additional to the histogram. But this is just now this linear regression thing with a standard error band. Or you can do a kind KDE, which stands for kernel density estimate. And this is what we saw earlier on. This is just this drawing the 2D density, now also directly proportional to color. And now on the marginals, you just get the one-dimensional density estimate, no longer the histogram. Okay. Then let's just go quickly through this. So this is also for linear things. You can also use linear model plot. Okay, so this is now for how you do faceting in Seaborn. So many Seaborn functions support a call aesthetic, so to say. This is probably the only thing where Seaborn is a little more grammar of graphically than ggplot, because you don't have a separate like facet grid thing that you have to specify, but you can really map again a variable to an aesthetic, and this aesthetic now is now the column of your facet. And this, if you just do this, it will create a facet plot, so to say, for each of those different groups of the different origins. however, just writes the group here in the title of the plot, and this is actually a problem if you do more facets. So here we now, I try to recreate the plot that we did with ggplot, with the 8 variables in a single plot with seaborn. That's actually not possible. For example, you cannot map continuous variables to color, you cannot map them to shape, and also becomes very unviewable. First we look at the plot, and then I talk about the code, or if it takes time, I first talk about the code. So if you want to make more complicated facet plots, where you do not just say, okay, map the column to this thing, then seaborn provides the so-called facet grid abstraction, where you first create a facet grid, and pass, this is somewhat like ggplot, you pass the data, and you pass this mapping here, you say, okay, I want to map rows to cylinders, columns to year, and hue to origin. And then on this grid object, you call a map function. And so map is something like from functional programming, where you say, okay, map a function on a collection of objects. So we think of this grid as a collection of plots with this specification, and now we map the matplotlib, the scatter plot function, we map on all of these small grids here, and we pass the arguments that we want to pass to scatter later on. Now we get a scatter plot on for each of those combinations, for cylinders and gear, of horsepower and weight, and then in the end we have to explicitly to add a legend. I don't know why it doesn't do it on its own, but we see already that now, since everything is in the title here, we cannot really view what is there. So this is nicer with ggplot, where this is really like very large on top of the row or the column, and not on top of every plot. Okay, so here's something now for customization with matplotlib. This basically just describes how you can get the original matplotlib figure object back from using either ggplot or seaborn. So if you want to make some customization, but if you need this, you can look at this at home, because we're running out of time. And I want to show Altair only once, because unfortunately we don't have time to look at this in this tutorial, though I would have liked to do it. The good thing is that Jack van der Plas, the developer, just on the last PyCon made a full tutorial on using Altair, so if you're interested in using this, you can watch this tutorial, you also have it here. And also the good thing is, now that you understood ggplot, you can basically use Altair without much practice, because it really just works the same, the API is just a little more Pythonic. So we can use, we can import Altair as ALT, we don't have to import from star again, that's cool. And then as in ggplot, we make not a ggplot object, but a chart. And then we call, instead of adding different layers, we just use method chaining. So this is just the default way in an object-oriented programming language to basically chain different expressions together. So we call mark circle here. So marks are the equivalent to geoms in ggplot. So we say, okay, we want to have every point represented by a circle now. And then we do this in code, and in code is the aesthetic mapping, the equivalent to this. So, and then we say, okay, we want to map X to horsepower, Y to weight, and color to origin. And the cool thing is, we can also just do dot interactive on the plot, and what we then get is this plot. It also looks nice by default, but we can also just zoom in and zoom out and pan around and stuff like this without doing any additional stuff. And really there's a lot more to doing interactions with Altair, where you can also select data and then display data conditioned on the selection. So this is very powerful and something that you should look in at some time. So then we have just our further readings as usual. So here's the talk by Jay van der Plas, who talks about all the visualization libraries that there are in Python, like 15 or something. So we cannot cover them all. But there is probably already the thing that you need in Python written somewhere. This is the full tutorial on Altair, exploratory data analysis Altair, and then there's also another tutorial from PyData, which focuses more on doing the same thing with matplotlib, pandas plotting, and also seaborn. Okay, so with that, are there any further questions right now? If not, then see you probably on Wednesday. Otherwise, next Monday when we do statistical modeling of Python.
Thank you.